My name is Debasree Sarkar. The title of my paper is To Be Clothed in Modesty, the Coming of the Bhadramahila Dressing the Sarkar. The 19th and early 20th centuries in India had witnessed the interaction of various contesting ideologies, including colonialism, reformist modernism, and traditionalist nationalism, making claims in relation to. Making claims in reshaping Indian culture, often causing lasting changes in various spheres, from education to clothes, an important marker of one's self-perception and cultural self-representation. From early 19th century onwards, Bengali reformers had been instrumental in several reforms enabling women to be more visible in the public sphere, which necessitated new modes of cultural construction of the modern Indian woman's appearance. Rather than focusing on the polemic and normative literature produced by reformers and traditionalists around women, a methodological intervention is extremely important to perceive these debates in a gendered perspective. This article explores the issue through women's own creative writings and autobiographical texts, studying the particular case of the making of the concept of Bhadramahila within the discourse around shame or lojja. One of the methods employed in the study is the method of historical research in the field of social relations, that is, directed search for an evaluation of relevant data and construction from the scattered images of a story of transformation of socio-cultural norms and values of this recorded period. The interdisciplinary approach makes it easier to grasp the idea about both the changing social structure and processes that served to make those changes and the changes in the notion of identity formation. The trends that were accepted or rejected by contemporary patrons and the masses following the changing standards of aesthetic evaluation of existing trends. The empirical areas of investigation in this regard are the socio-economic status of the female writers, their relations with the intelligentsia, and their perspective on the changing society around them. The impact of the new print culture on the production of a shared space by women with a privilege, that was education, and the role of the critics whose views were reflected in the newspaper articles. This study is relevant in the modern context also, as we will be exploring the 19th century reform movements through a gender lens, contesting the dominating trends which portrayed the women's question as a male agenda and women's participation in this discourse always at the receiving end, changing the prevailing cultural imaginaries by locating women's voices in their educational and ceremonial reform projects, by listening to their actual day-to-day life stories. An attempt has been made to throw light on the origins of the cultural hegemony, which can be traced from the clash of two cultures in the colonial framework of 19th century Bengal. Through the gradual silencing of some ideas, the changing meaning of the embodiment of the traditional notions of shame, the appropriation of some foreign notions and making them Indianized, and the modernization of the old rural notions of Griha Lakshmi or Shobhadhurmi. I will be looking at non-institutional ideas and contents for and by women in the 19th century Bengali periodicals, keeping in mind that the concept of shame or its departure, the body of the ideal Indian woman, is neither static nor natural. The colonial rule introduced a capitalist regime into India and produced a new form of patriarchy which provided the rationale for reforms, recasting male domination. Those who accepted the idea that society's ill could be traced to the oppressed condition of Indian women folk saw female education and through it female emancipation as the first step towards progress. Bengal was the heart of this modernizing endeavor. Women's education was one of the items on the reform agenda of the 19th century Bengali reformers. The element of serendipity in education made many educated women acknowledge and define their own problems. Women writers or lekhika emerged as a new category. They wrote about themselves, about their problems, began asking for their rights, participated in the social life, organized women organizations, and created a space for themselves in the outer world. Himani Banerjee has shown the colonial context of the construction of lojja and how the Victorian patriarchal lens degraded and delegitimized the display of women's sexuality, and how women themselves imbibed this notion of shame and viewed themselves through the colonial patriarchal lens. Neglecting the emergence of a new dressing sense in women, out of this discourse creating ground for women's more frequent public appearance. I will be dealing with women's autonomous agency in the discourse, women's emancipation from the confined state of Antapur, and how women, through their otherwise negligible endeavors, resisted the prevailing conditions which regulated the movement and presence of their bodies in public places, through tracing the simultaneous gradual development of female education. One of the first who availed the enabling hands of the new print media to claim a space of her own from the obscurity of being an upper caste class woman confined in the sexually segregated space of an elite household was Shashwat Mulindi. A widow of a wealthy landlord of the village Ramadiya, her autobiography Amar Jibun, first published in 1876, is the oldest autobiography written in Bengali. Rashundari was a devotee of 19th century Bengal for whom the wish to read the Chaitanya Bhagavat was the driving force in her desire to learn to read. Learning to read in the confines of her gunta, that is the drooping cover of shari, in the intermittent attention paid to the printed pages in her kitchen against the oaths of a social taboo regarding women's education, which she herself stated as viruddha dharma, which is sacrilege, she never gave in to the thoughts that the prevailing condition of women's education was because of her God's own will. Rather, whenever she got a chance to learn or to read, she interpreted that chance as the designs of her faithful God. It speaks about the ethos, the structure of feeling, which is culture in the material, in the sense of a fluid and irrational formation posited against a system of belief which can be called as the prevailing cultural ethos. Rashundari could transgress social norms for her God wanted her to do it. In her autobiography, even though Rashundari never spoke directly against the prevailing condition of veiling of the face and the confined state of the contemporary woman folk, there is a general sense of contempt regarding these practices. This gets clear when she says this. So this locked up condition made the women shy, or at least gave them an idea of shame, which was an impediment for that emancipation. Therefore, comparing her 12 years old self to her 25 years old self, Rashundari stated initially that she felt ashamed to go even in front of her husband's horse, fearing that he would see her, but later realized it as a meritless act and laughed at her concept of shame. Around this time, she stopped veiling her face and head and started to talking with the maid servants and the sisters of her husband, running the works of her shomshar, which is household. Effectively was put forward as the reason behind these acts. Around this time, another educated upper class Hindu woman, Shodamini Kastubhidi, wrote many articles in Bhamapadini Potrika. Here we can get the example of how Victorian Puritanism affected the general consciousness of the contemporary Bengali minds. In Lodgers, he said, the kind of clothing that women wear here in Bengal, it's not considered reprehensible only because it is customary to do so, but upon even a slightest reflection, it will become apparent that it is only a little better than remaining naked by throwing a fine piece of cloth. Shodamini was married to a zamindar, became a Brahmo around 1865, and read many movements on widow marriage and women's education in Borishal district. Still, she repudiated female physical exposure and offered instead a proposal for hiding the female body in a textile enclosure. The note of revulsion in her lines expressed the direction of her thought, where the Bhadramahila must signify something other than the accustomed vulgarity of a female body, unselfconsciously draped in a semi-transparent piece of cloth. In the above-mentioned article, she connects body with class by making it clear that the female body of the propertied classes is different from that of the laboring classes. It is not to be seen directly in terms of its potential for reproduction or productive labor. The same, as an adornment of women, both displaces the upper class caste woman from her body as well as solely identifies her with it. For all the writers, Lodger is a desirable social ethic of morality and civilization rather than of denial and repression. An example of this social ethic is seen in essays on common or public bathing by women. Denying its long existence as a daily practice in the villages or on ritual occasions, the writers emphasize it as a form of sexual transgression. Shame thus becomes a way of defining and institutionalizing virtue and vice through segregation and self-surveillance. Thus, this theme of segregation or conditional presence of women in the public life, particularly in front of the male gaze, draws attention to the fact that in the agenda of moral regulation of the female body, is invested in different ways in private and public spaces and in terms of the onlooker, and these differences are to be expressed by clothes. A woman's clothes and presence thus possesses a set of architectural and social correlates coded as ondormo, that is inner quarters, and bahi, that is outside world. With the proposal for social reform or change in that ideology of social reproduction in which the separate outer and inner domains become the notion of home or hearth, which can be termed as griho, then arose the idea of women's emergence and freedom. The necessity and the origin of the social innovations and renovations are always referred back to these notions of women's emergence, the fusion of the inner and outer social spaces, and renovation in the sexual division of labor. But woman did not follow the prescribed norms blindly. Rashtrangari prioritized her bhakti for her god to learn to eat and used household work, the main role of early 19th century Bhadramahila, to come out of the blindness of her ghumka. Koilashvashini Devi, another contemporary woman who studied at the knives, another tutelage of her husband, wrote against the customs of the overarching patriarchal structure and stood on women and spoke for a middle path, but without neglecting the traditional roles women could maintain a space in society, or without shedding their Indianness, they could be Western. But all these women were still floating behind the veil of tradition, and what they owed were, for many women of the time, unsuitable to get up in front of anyone or in public. The next generation of women who were formally educated in schools and at a later stage in colleges stepped out from the inner borders. After the Bethune School was established in Calcutta, it was difficult to find women students. So Devendranath Tagore had sent his eldest daughter Shodamini Devi and her sister Shornukumari Devi. Soon other progressive families started to send their daughters to study at Bethune. Shornukumari Devi was the fourth daughter of Devendranath and one of the first successful women novelists in Bengal. She edited Bharati for many years and established Shoki Shomiti for the needy distressed women to educate them so that they could earn a living. Acharya Ajodhyanath Padrashi was appointed as their teacher, and Devendranath gave Keshav Chandra Sen and his family shelter in his home. So two unrelated men came for the first time into the inner quarters of Antapur around this time. In the writings of Shodamini and Shornukumari, you can find an example of gradually vanishing Antapur or inner quarter being replaced by modern customs and ways of life. Shornukumari talked about the obstacles for girls to get out of the home. What women owed in those days was, for some women of that age, with Victorian puritanism imbibed in their consciousness, unsuitable to go out in public and unmanageable. The elite women locked up in their houses owed different kind of costly shadis, including balu chori, jamdani, chok, hata, pacha bere, most of which had a fine surface. The curves of the body would be visible in the folds of the shadi. The backside would often be uncovered in an attempt to pull the end of the shadi up to the breasts to cover her face. The man who changed the course of women's lives by enabling them to get out of the blindness of illiteracy were the first ones to make a move which facilitated the changes in women's surgical representations. The next generation of men were not only interested in educating their wives to make them better mothers or more efficient housewives, rather what they wanted was shogodhurmi, wives who would deal with them, pray with them, be with them, most importantly, not under the night sky, but in broad daylight, in the parks or in the social parties in the houses of the British lords. When for the first time Shottendranath took Ganodhanandini with him to Bombay, Ganodhanandini was taken to the ship in a palanquin only. When they returned 2 years after going to Bombay, then nobody in the house could ask her to enter the house by riding palanquin, and the housewife came out of the car like a foreign woman. The change that had started internally from going to Bombay was now speeded up by Ganodhanandini coming back to Jodhpur. She not only imbibed the notions but contributed to the notions which helped in making of a woman's society of Mohila Shamas. By creating new dressing styles, new social practices and supporting women's free movement outside the house, which eventually broke the sexual segregation of women. Even though the new dressing style covered the potent sexuality of women's body and made it permissible for her walk in public places, it helped many women after her to claim a public identity outside the home. Her daughter, Indira Devi, had said this about her. This one. Shottendranath's friend, Mr. Bihari Lal Gupta's wife, Shodamini Gupta, was the first woman to came to learn how to wear Brahmika style of shari. Wearing the shari in the Brahmika style, Rajlokhi Sen was praised by the then Governor General in the annual program of Bethune School in 1865. In 1866, Ganodhanandini went to the assembly at the house of the Governor Lord Lawrence as Shottendranath was unwell, and he sent his wife in his place. In 1871, the Bhadramahili Sabha arranged a seminar on women's clothing. A description of that discussion was published in the Bhadramahili. In the writings on this subject, three things were most common. They all agreed on the expensive nature of the European clothes and its unaffordability for the Bengali women. They all wanted something Indian to be the attire of Bengali Bhadramahila, and as Rajlokhi Sen said in Bhadramahili, by bad women, probably she was talking about the prostitutes of the time, as even before the housewives of Bengali elite or middle class families, they started wearing the reformed clothes. So it was natural that the educated Bhadramahila of the elite or propertied household of Bengal of the time would want to look especially different from the women who wear the other, as they represented all the other things that the term Bhadramahila stood for: family, motherhood, divine nature, an embodiment of real shame and real modesty. These upper class, middle class women, by the practice of cultural modifications and experimentations, provided semiology and ideology of culture and class in a completely embodied and engendered fashion.
We need to start concluding.
Okay, sir. So, as I have mentioned in the beginning of this chapter, from the early 19th century onwards, Bengali reformers have been instrumental in numerous reform projects, from abolishing shati to fixing minimum age of consent for females for marriage, and several other reforms which facilitated women's public appearance. With the increase of women's presence in the public domain, the issue of dressing, the right conduct in public space for those emancipated women, and the appropriate ways of life for them became matters of further debate. In the earlier times, male protagonists played the main roles of reformers, and in most cases, women's own voices were somewhat missing from the debates regarding the issues related to their own bodies and familial social status. As we can see in this discussion above, in the debate on appropriate female education for the class of the Bhadramahila and the surgery representation, the women of the upper middle class urban families were very much active with their male counterparts, and soon they were the main protagonists of these reform projects. This marks a change from the earlier reforms of the early 19th century Bengal. After the emergence of this modern educated women, the reform process continued with other social and political movements, like the emerging nationalist movement of the time. Unlike other reform projects, women's surgical representation politics did not entail any legal change facilitated by the male reformers, but the upper middle class women, through their lifestyle, at times created new stereotypes by breaking the prevailing norms, at times appropriated the old stereotypes, contributing overall to a slow but gradual process of reform all along the 19th to the early 19th century. If you read between the lines in all these discussions of change and continuity, tradition and modernity, the dilemmas regarding adopting foreign norms or retaining local, regional, national norms of consciousness and values, educational and the surgical, was all about social identity and political subjectivity. From the 1860s onwards, regional patriotism was gradually turning into nationalism in many parts of Bengal and was being linked to the larger politics of Indian nationalism. Women also played a significant role in this process. The Age of Consent Act of 1891 has often been considered a watershed in the reformist project, as the educated, influential modern men were gradually being drawn towards the emerging nationalist politics. Projects of social reforms backed by laws implemented by the colonial government were losing their appeal. In fact, the Age of Consent Act had faced a huge resistance from the Orthodox section. According to Partho Chatterjee, the abeyance of the women's question was not a failure of liberal thought, or was not censored from the reformist agenda, but nationalism had in fact resolved the women's question in complete accordance with its preferred roots. But through the discussion, this article can also suggest that even if the women's question was resolved for the male reformers of the time, it was not the same for the women counterparts. A new space was created, new institutions were established, a new generation of educated women emerged. They attended schools, meetings, public gatherings, and wrote vociferously about what women want.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.